the focus has shifted once again to the infrastructure sector. The Prime Minister's office has promised quick clearances, implementation and monitoring of projects, and a revival of sectors like power that have been caught in a bind. But has all the talk translated into actual action and traction on the ground? That's the question I asked Atul Punj. Is the story of India's infrastructure going to be one step forward and two back, or has it improved?
I think right now we're trying to struggle to come back from the two steps back. You have challenges which are resulting in a huge problem in terms of the power build-out that we all know about, issues to do with land acquisition, coal linkages, environmental clearances. If you just look at the sheer number of projects that have been given licenses and what stage they've reached, it's abysmal performance. You have a lot of gas-fired power plants, for example, where the power plants are up, pipelines are built to connect them with gas supplies, but there's no gas. So you have idling capacity on the gas side as well. So almost everywhere you look, our ability for time to market for a particular project is way behind the rest of the world standards. It's easier today, for example, I was in Sri Lanka last week, to put up a power plant in Sri Lanka and probably put an undersea cable into India, because your coal is coming from either Africa, from Indonesia, Australia, South Africa, Mozambique. So in any case, you're right there, and Sri Lanka is just, you know, a stone's throw away from the southern tip. And simply clearances will be that much faster. So we find that there's too many agencies that are involved, whether it's on the highway side, whether it's on the power side, whether it's on the port side, whether it's on, you want to build a shipyard. It is just too time consuming. And every day you find that there's some new change in regulation, there's no real transparency about exactly what you need to do, where you need to do, barring some states which have taken the ownership of really building out infrastructure. We all know which ones they are, which are different from the rest of the country. But overall, we have gone two steps back, if not three.
Over the last 2 years, you've all spoken about policy paralysis and infrastructure not really getting the leg up it needed. A lot of infrastructure companies, including yours, have faced the flak for it. This year, with all the noise and the hope of progress, has there been change on the ground?
See, awarding contracts is not solving the problem. Okay, and I think they tend to people tend to see that the number of contracts or the kilometers on highways, as an example, is showing that there's a major movement in the sector. The point is, are you really geared up as a nation that says that all agencies are now committed to this happening? Are you able to deliver the right of way on time? Are you willing to take the politically unfamiliar popular step,
yeah,
okay, of dealing with local issues, whether it's moving a small temple or a small mosque or moving some other place which is significant to the locals? Are you willing to reroute your line around the highway around those obstacles? Are your tree cutting permissions coming from the right agencies at the right time? The disputes that arise, and all contracts globally, right, have a difference of opinion between the owner and the contractor and the engineer. Now, everywhere else in the world, they have sorted out the dispute resolution in a seamless manner that within 3 to 6 months after your project is done, you have come to a conclusion. In India, it's a minimum five to seven year wait.
But this has always been a problem.
Right.
Has it been exaggerated because of other issues over the last 2 years?
It has been exaggerated because the sheer number of projects that have been floated out have resulted in that many more litigations, which means the system, which is already constrained to resolve these disputes, is hugely overburdened, right? The B.K. Chaturvedi report has been on the table. Everybody knows what needs to be done. But everything seems to be done in little bits and pieces. It's not taken up in a holistic manner that, okay, what are the issues dealing with, that are affecting this sector? How do we resolve them and make sure that everybody is aligned, and we end up saying that we want to build a great nation, okay, that reflects the great nation that we are? That's not happening.
Let's break it down to verticals, because, you know, building India is about the multiple verticals that go into it.
Sure.
Let's talk about power, for instance. You have a big exposure. You build some of the big power plants in the country.
Correct.
We've seen a situation where pretty much a lot of it is at the risk of being mothballed because of few linkages. And while we've seen the government try and act, we've not seen anything on the ground. What's your assessment of
it? Well, I mean, you've pretty much said what the problem is, that, you know, you've got a country which is sitting on one of the largest coal reserves in the world. Arguably, they may have a high ash content, they may not be the best coal in the world, but you can talk about blending them, you can talk about various other solutions to resolving the problem. But yet, okay, we are, as we were seeing, the deficit is just increasing by leaps and bounds. So it's the linkages, it's the clearances, it's now the financing, because a lot of the projects are now being questioned in terms of their financial viability, right? So it's just everything is just, it's not, just not coming together the way it should. The first flurry of projects happened, but now suddenly you're seeing banks are getting wary, all right, of financing any infrastructure project. Okay, so the sector suddenly from being the golden boy on the block to being, oh, let's just wait and watch what happens here before we take any more exposure. So all around there seems to be a lot of confusion or a lack of direction about what is happening. Policy paralysis, I don't think, has affected the sector as much as the confusion around what all do you need to have in place to make it successful. As I said, awarding contracts is simply not, or giving a license, is not resolving the problem. At best, you may be passing the problem from your own door to somebody else who's agreed to do it for a particular price. But if the environment does not allow him to do that effectively at that price, your problem is not being solved. So that's the issue.
So for a company like yours, yeah, which does EPC contracts, which builds it, what is, how does it cascade into you, really, at this juncture? Because the stress is at the power company's end. You are turnkey project manager. So how does it impact you?
Well, we, you know, 80% of our backlog is outside India. Okay, India is only 20% of what we do. But the work that we do in India, fortunately, we have chosen our clients carefully. They're all financially closed out. We don't have any projects which really got into trouble. But we hear the buzz from our clients that they are worried about some of the issues that are likely to crop up tomorrow in terms of their ability to transport coal, to export the coal, and in many cases where they have the blocks already available. So one is not seeing that many new projects coming. So in terms of visibility of new orders in the power space is fairly muted.
So let's look at the orders going forward. Do you think the current environment, because you know every day you have a new set of terrible headlines, you know, there is the drought fear, there is the policy fear, there is the rate fear, there's a pushing back of rates. How has all of this combined and has that pushed any investment forward?
No, I think the general lack of willingness of individual companies or groups to take the plunge in a more significant manner in the infra space, okay, that is definitely muted. You're not seeing the kind of traction that you saw 4 years ago. All right, there's been a definite slowdown in that. Will it come back? What will make it come back? I think really is for somebody in the government to look at all the issues regarding each one of the verticals in the infra space and looking and seeing what is required to be done to resolve the issues of all stakeholders.
Right now, it's been made out that a little bit of an interest rate cut could revive sentiment. Is it as simplistic as that?
Don't think it's being, but right now, you know, things have reached such a level where you think that anything, okay, is a positive sign. I mean, that's really how, unfortunately, things are at this point. So any direction from the government that is positive will be taken and will have some impact, but I don't believe it's going to solve the problem.
How much stress can it can get exaggerated going forward? I'm talking about an industry-specific thing, not company-specific. If this situation continues for the next 6 to 8 months, how do you see it panning out?
Well, you know, the gestation period to get a project up and running, okay, is typically about 4 years from identifying the project to actually getting it completed. So the longer you wait, okay, the more the country has to wait for getting its infrastructure act together.
The general sense was Indian companies were getting frustrated with what is happening here and then going abroad. But you've always had a far greater exposure overseas in terms of business. How's that?
Well, there's a historical angle to that. You know, when I started this business, it was 1990 when VP Singh's government was in power. So we had capability, okay, but there was no opportunity. So that's when we started looking out with our first break in Indonesia. And after that, I swore to myself, never risk yourself in any one country, any one geography, and any one vertical. So consciously, over the last 20 odd years, we've been building out new verticals, new geographies. But yeah, sometimes you get hit by the surprise like Libya, okay, which nobody planned, or nobody could have planned for, given what we knew of it in early January and what happened in February last year. So, but that's, you know, risk that comes with the territory. But we have consciously always been looking at moving into new geographies where the competitive intensity is less, all right? Unlike India, where the competitive intensity in any new sector just goes ridiculously high.
In Libya, has there been an improvement, a perceptible improvement? It's coming back, and are you confident about the outlays going forward, etc.?
Yeah, they have money. It's not a country that is short of funds. So it's not a function of economics over there. They're a country of 4 or 5 million people. They export 2.5 million barrels approximately of, or 2 million barrels of oil a day. Contrasted to Iraq with maybe about 40 million people with the same oil production. So the financials are great. The problem was institutional there because there was a freeze in all government decision making. We had a bunch of contracts. We had an upstream drilling contract that has been renegotiated, restarted, and money started coming through. Claims have been paid out. We have five infra projects. Two have been renegotiated. Three discussions are going on right now. The pipeline, again, they have asked us to file our claims for the period that work was suspended and damages, which we are currently doing. That should also start. I'd be very surprised if by the end of this year, all the projects are not back on track. Yeah, I think India is probably the only country in the world that has outsourced almost all its highway program to the private sector. It's unheard of anywhere in the world.